So we've moved now from the series of how to grow to how to stand. And we began looking at Ezekiel 22. Which admonishes us to intercede, to stand in the gap on behalf of others. And I want to thank Kaya for doing such a good job in sharing her experience of intercession. Let's look at Ezekiel 22, and I'm going to begin with the first verse today. The prophet Ezekiel speaks on behalf of God to Jerusalem. He says, "Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me saying, 'Now, son of man, will you judge the bloody city?'" If you go through that particular chapter, you may find blood, bloodshed, or bloody, however it's written in your Bible, a number of 7 times. It's a bloody city, and it speaks of defilement. It speaks of murder that's going on in that particular city. Let's turn to Psalm 132, verse 13, because I want you to see how far the city of Jerusalem has turned away from God. When David became king, he established Jerusalem as Zion. It was God's dwelling place on the earth. It was God's favorite place. It was a holy city. The scripture says, "For the Lord has chosen Zion. He has desired it for his" what? His dwelling place. It was near and dear to his heart. It was the place for his chosen people. But now, people have moved away from God. They've turned their backs on God. And Ezekiel describes it as a bloody city, full of defilement, full of violence. This morning, as I was meditating, I thought about a situation that I heard on the news, that the light of the Statue of Liberty had gone out. And many commentators connected that situation to the light that has gone out in America. The Statue of Liberty was the light that welcomed immigrants into the country. There was a light of morality. There is a light of love, the light of hospitality that seems to have gone out in America. And we can say that here in this particular verse, Ezekiel is charging, saying the light of Jerusalem has gone out. The songs of innocence that the children once sang, "This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine," have now been changed to lyrics of violence, where one group talks about attacking and murdering another group. Yes, show her all her abominations. Then say, thus says the Lord God, the city sheds blood in her own midst, that her time may come. That her time may come is speaking of the judgment that's about to come on Israel. Now, they had moved so far away from God in the place of morality that other nations were now looking at them with questions, looking at them with mockery. As I spoke of this on yesterday, it really, really hit me, because that's what's happening in America as the light of the Lord seemingly has gone out over our nations. Other nations are looking at what's going on in America with great question. Now let's get into this in more detail to understand why there was a need for somebody to stand in the gap, and why there's a need for us to stand in the gap for America. Let's look at verse 6, Ezekiel 22, verse 6. Look, the princes of Israel, the princes of Israel. You know what the princes of Israel is? It's really critical. The city officials. The princes of Israel, each one has used his power to shed blood in you. If you're making notes, or if you are, you can make notes in your Bible, you could read that. Look, the officials of Israel, each one have abused power to shed blood in the city. How did they abuse power? Say as an official, as a judge, you come into my courtroom. There's been a mistake of identity, and somebody's brought you into a court. And although all the evidence points to the fact that you are innocent, because of the wickedness in my heart as an official, I sentence you guilty. And I sentence you to die. Execution, or you die in prison. And the reason for this sentence is because I'm going to hook up my friends to take your property. And that's the kind of thing that was going on in Jerusalem. Look, the princes of Israel, each one abused his power to shed blood in the city. Are you listening? Let's go to verse 7. In you, in this city that once shined with the light of God's glory, in you, you've made light a father and mother. So not only does he address the princes, the officials, now Ezekiel is to address the parents. And, or first of all, the children of the parents. Exodus 20 tells us to honor your mother and your father so that your days may be long. That's a promise of the Lord. Over my years, I've seen situations where my peers were disrespectful to their parents. And you know what? They're not here. They're not here, or they're locked up. There's something to the word of God, isn't it? Honor your mother and father so that your days may be long. Apparently, there was some disrespect going on in Jerusalem. Children were not respecting their mother and their father. It's hard for me to go to. I can't even imagine it. And the disrespect didn't stop there, Rita. They were disrespecting their grandparents. And God knew, God knows the effect that this kind of disrespect can have on society. It can tear away, it can break down the fabric of the family. So, for my young folks that are here, respect your parents. Respect adults. Amen. So that your days will be long and prosperous and glorious. Amen. Now, on the other side of that, is as parents, we expect respect from our children, but we also have to give respect. Amen. And so Ephesians 6 says, fathers, don't provoke your children to wrath. In other words, give them the kind of love that they desire, that they long for. Don't put them in a situation where they're open to the wiles of the enemy. Because the love that children don't get at home, they will try to get it somewhere else, not even knowing what they're doing. But we want to love, parents, we want to love, we want to love, we want to lift our children up so that they can be all that God designed them to be. Amen. Now, when these things are not going right in the household, it can have a ripple effect in terms of society. Amen. If Brianna, my girl, my spiritual daughter, is not taught how to respect her mother and her grandmother, her family, then how is she going to be in terms of her relationship with widows and those that are in need? But this is what happens, and I didn't know why I mentioned Brianna, but now at this very moment, I know why. She has such a close relationship with her mother and her grandmother, and they have taught her these principles that now she's using her giftings as a dancer, right? To help those that are in need, to help special needs folks. You see what happens when we teach our children in the ways of the Lord. Let's give God glory for truth right here. Let's continue on now. with verse 8. First, he talks to what? The princes? Who are what? The city officials. Then he speaks to who? The parents. And now he's speaking to the priest. You got to talk to the priest. Yeah. Priest, you have despised my holy things, and you have profaned the Sabbath. So the very things that I've established, you've turned your backs on, and you've allowed, facts about it, you've encouraged people to worship the God of the mountains, the God of the sun, the God of the moon. People are going to the mountains and they're setting up shrines and all of this. And rather than speaking to these issues and speaking the truth, you've turned your backs on them. And the passages underneath that begin to show us the impact of the people in Jerusalem when they're not getting the truth. They're in bondage to all kinds of things. That's from verses 8 through 11. Praise God for the truth. How many of you know the truth will make you free? Hallelujah. Let's keep going. Verse 12. Now, Ezekiel is to speak to property owners. So, thus far, he's spoken to what? The princes? The who else? Parents and priests. And now, property owners, managers. In your city, you take bribes to shed blood. You take usury. In other words, people come to you for loans and you charge them these high interests. Yeah. Yeah, you're seeing this. Martin Luther King says this, and it's so powerful, and you write it down if you can. Every condition exists simply because someone profits by its existence. Every condition exists simply because someone profits by its existence. This economic exploitation is crystallized in the slum. Every condition exists simply because someone profits by its existence. So the slums exist because somebody profits from the slums. The ghettos exist because someone profits from life in the ghetto. Prisons, thank you, buddy, exist because somebody is profiting from the prison pipeline. This court system, people going in and out, exists because there is profit in this. Matthew Desmond, in his book, Evicted, says that it's good in the hood. There's money to be made off of the poor in the hood. Twelve million people or more this year will go to some payday lending institute, be charged high interest rates. And it's not because, and I want us to, there was a lesson this week, and I mean, I heard some things this week, and my spirit just dropped. And how we tend to judge people by what we perceive. And often the people that go to these places are not going there because they're trying to live above their means. They're trying to put food on the table. They're trying to keep the lights on. They're trying to avoid being homeless. But yet there's a strategy there. There's a tactic that's targeting that particular group. Not only those there, but even young people who are trying to move up. And they go to college, this college for profit, and they take out student loans. And all of those things are designed, son, to pull money out of the pockets of the poor. And this is what the Lord was charging of the property owners in Ezekiel's time. You take, you rob, you scam. And that's happening now. See how relevant the word is? Okay. So then, let's look at it further. Verse 28. He not only speaks to the property owners, but he speaks to the prophets. As a prophet is looking into the future, they don't see the hand of God getting ready to move with judgment on Jerusalem. They instead tell everybody that everything is all right. You don't need to make any improvements. You don't need to listen to Jeremiah. There's no need to listen to Ezekiel and Isaiah. They're off. How many of you know that if there ever was a time to get right with the Lord, it's now? It's right now. It's right now. So then, we come to verse 30. With all of this going on, God says, now tell the people, I sought for an intercessor among them who would do what? Make a wall and stand. Encounter, endure, we said. Have a face-to-face in the gap. Who would stand, who would intercede in the gap before me on behalf of the people in the land. And the indictment was this: I found nobody. I found nobody. Let me pause for a moment. If the Holy Spirit was to set up a table in the foyer of those who would intercede on behalf of the nation right now, I wonder how many takers he would get. How many people would be willing to stand in the gap? At that moment, at that time, it's sad that the Lord couldn't find anybody. And judgment came into the city. The glory of the Lord departed from the temple. The light of Jerusalem went out. The people went into 70 years of Babylonian captivity. That's sad. That's sad. He said, I couldn't find anybody. Not then. But thanks be unto Jesus Christ, who the Lord sent to stand in the gap. And still today, we said, he never ceases to make intercession. Amen. And praise Jesus right now that he stands in the gap for us. Now, as we look at all these things that are going on in Ezekiel, I want to tell you that there's a force behind it. There's an unseen force behind it. Let's go to 1 Timothy 6 and 10, and I'm almost done. 1 Timothy 6 and 10. Can we read this together? For the love of money. What is the root of all kinds of evil? Money itself? The love of money. I want you to get that. What is it?
The love of money.
Let's go to Matthew 6. Matthew 6 and 24. It carries this thought out for us even deeper and causes us to look inward to see where we are. Let's read it together. No one can serve. You cannot serve what?
God.
You can't serve what?
God.
Now, many people think that mammon is synonymous to money. And for that reason, we've had many people over the years to make an oath of poverty. Because they look at mammon as money. It's deeper than that. Mammon is a spirit that's anti-God. Mammon, if you will, operates in the second heavens. You know the scripture. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. Spiritual wickedness in high places. Mammon, oh my God, as I'm seeing it, I'm seeing your face, some things are coming to my mind. Mammon is some kind of force. Jesus knew that. And he says, You can't serve God and serve mammon, this God, at the same time. You're going to love one and hate the other, or you will be loyal to one and disloyal to the other. Mammon is some kind of spirit. It's anti-God, doesn't want you to worship God as your source. How many of you know that God is your source? Can you say, God is my source?
God is my source.
God's my source. He allows me to acquire money for the purpose, for the sole purpose of advancing his kingdom. However, the spirit of mammon works in another direction. He wants you to see him as the source. And as you operate under the spirit of mammon, then you become this instrument to make more money for this particular force. And he drives you. You become his slave. He drives you. He moves you. I said this on yesterday, and I hope I can say it the way I was thinking it. God is my source. Can you say, God is my source?
God is my source.
Now, again, mammon hates that. Mammon wants you to recognize him as the source, and he's so tricky that he will sometimes cause you to use God to get money. For your own glory, for your own good. And we see this practiced many times within the body of Christ. We can take little things such as a prayer shawl and capitalize off of it.
Amen.
I'll take that prayer shawl and I can be real slick with it. Use principles and how people shrouded themselves in the prayer cloth and were healed. Use the fact that the woman with an issue of blood touched the hem of Jesus' garment. He had this prayer shawl on. I can talk about that and then take it and tie it to the fact that I know you got a need. I know it. And if you send me $217, I'll send you this prayer shawl. Well, if you don't have $217, I'll take $20.17. Now, for $217, I'll send you the prayer shawl with the blue cord. But for $2017, I'll send you the regular one. Desperate people do desperate things. And it's because of the spirit of mammon that people, individuals, are able to capitalize. And it's the spirit of mammon. That's moving on America today. Yeah. It's the spirit of mammon that's moving in the church today. But we come against it now in the name of Jesus and put praises together as we come further into the truth. Amen. Let me give you one more passage here. Let's go to Matthew 9. As we see the one who interceded. And what did that look like? Matthew 9 and 35. Pay close attention to this in the way Matthew describes it. Then Jesus did what? What did he do? He went about all the cities and villages teaching. There's your mission right there. Reaching, teaching, restoring, and building. That's what he did. He goes in the villages. He goes in the city. He's in the synagogues. He's preaching the gospel of the kingdom. And he's healing what? I like the way you emphasize that. He's healing what? Are you happy to know that no sickness is beyond the power of our God? Amen. He's healing every sickness. Can you say every disease?
Every disease.
I praise God right now that there's no disease that's beyond the power of my God. My God is a great God. My God is a powerful God. My God can do anything. Hallelujah. He is Jehovah Rapha. He is a healer. Can you praise the healer right now? He heals every sickness, every disease. Among the people. Give me the next verse. Jesus goes amongst the people. Can you say he went amongst the people? He's not aloof. He goes amongst the people. And when you go amongst the people, you have a sense of what they're going through. He saw the multitudes and he was moved with compassion because, pay attention to this, because they were weary, they were hurting and scattered like sheep with no shepherd. Those individuals who don't know God are like sheep with no shepherd. And pardon me, but I'm just seeing some things, and it's impacting me on the inside. Because having come through the streets, knowing what's going on, you know that there are wolves in sheep's clothing just ready to attack and tear people apart. And Jesus saw this. And he doesn't just look at it and shake his head. No, no, no. Listen to what he says in the next verse. and then we'll come to the altar. He said to his disciples, which means he's saying to us, right? Amen. The harvest is what? What's the problem? Nobody to stand in the gap. The time that you need workers in the cycle of the farming is a time of harvest. And if you don't have the folks in line to gather up the harvest, the crop is lost. It's lost. It's gone. I got such a painful illustration of this past summer and spring. I had a garden and it was doing great. Great, 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 great. But you know what the problem was? It was growing faster than I could pick things. So I had okra. Died on the vine. Tomatoes died on the vine. Greens, cabbage, gone. Should have been on the table. Gone. There's harvest out there. Ripe and ready. Why aren't we out there pulling them in? Amen. Amen. Jesus says the harvest is truly plentiful. What's the problem? And the next verse, the last thing we're going to look at. Therefore, do what?
Pray.
Stop, stop, stop. Do what? Do what?
Pray.
Pray. Specifically, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. And when you pray to the Lord of the harvest, and when you're willing to do your part, lives will be changed. And the light that's gone out in the city will be restored as you are God's beacon of light.
Amen.
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 But what we got to do is what?
Pray.
Pray. Pray. Everybody stand. Do you know anybody around you that's weary? Do you know of any families that have been scattered? Do you know of anybody that's hurting and in need of the truth? Do you? I'm sure you do. And the Lord says, stand in the gap for them. Pray that they will come into the fold. Because right now, they're sheep without a shepherd. Did you know this year, well, in the last 18 months, there have been 8 teen suicides in the Cincinnati Public School District. There's a power of darkness that's looming over this city. It's threatening to snuff out the light. And God is looking for people who will stand in the gap. Will you be one of the ones to stand in the gap so that we don't have to bury another child of suicide? Will you be one to stand in the gap so that we can evict the demons of hell from this region? I see mothers and grandmothers whose hearts are now impacted by this. Will you join me at the altar? Will you intercede? Parents, can you help me?